All right, my name is Rich Schmidt. I'm here with Guillaume Larche. We're at Resonance Wines in Carlton. It's August 20th, 2020. Thank you so much for joining us today. We really appreciate this. First question for you is, why wine?
So, at first, thank you for being with us this afternoon, and thank you for your beautiful pronunciation for my first name. I appreciate it, you know. So, why wine? It's a good question, but that would be a long response, you know. But this is because this is a passion for me, not from my birth, but from a long time. You know, I had the chance to grow up in Burgundy, you know, where my family owns a small vineyard, a very small vineyard in Pouilly-Fuissé area, so Mâconnais, south of Burgundy, you know, and voilà, I discovered the wine, you know, all the business around the wine with my grandfather, who owned the vineyard, and he had an amazing cellar, you know, and I remember, you know, when it was a moment to have a dinner with the family or a lunch, he asked me to come to help, you know, to take some bottle, and that was the first connection with the wine, and of course the moment of the harvest, you know, maybe a little bit more in Burgundy, it's a little bit a tradition, you know, to harvest the weekend with your family, you know, to pick the grapes together, but that was for me the memory of a good moment, you know, mm-hmm. a moment that you share with your family, with your cousins, with voilà, and I didn't plan to work in the wine industry, to be very honest with you. My parents didn't work in the wine industry, but voilà, this is the hazard, you know. I had to change my professional way. Mm-hmm. I started to study law, public law. I have a great passion for history, and that was my first study, you know, to make a career using my passion to work. But if you have a passion for history, you know, you don't have a lot of options to work. Alors, I decided to make a career in the French army. I started a school of officer, and unfortunately, you know, today, fortunately, but at this time, I was a little bit embarrassed by that, but I had some issue with my eyes, and that didn't allow me to continue in this way. Mm-hmm. So I had to stop. I had to stop after a graduation in law. I had to stop, and I worked during 1 year with my cousin in the vineyard and in the cellar. And for me, that was really a revelation, something that I didn't imagine, that it was so complex, you know, that it was so meticulous, finally, to produce grapes and to make wine. And so I decided that to turn this passion for the wine into my job. Mm-hmm. Voilà. And so I restarted studies in viticulture and enology with different graduation, but I was graduated with a master degree in enology, so the Diplôme National d'Oenologue, National Diploma of Oenologist at the University of Dijon, the Institut Jules Guyot. And during this time, you know, I visited a lot of cellar, I visited a lot of winery, and I discovered the Maison de Négoce, the Négociant. Mm-hmm. In Burgundy, in Beaune, this is the capital of the Négociant, Beaune, and this is something that makes sense for me, this connection between the past, the tradition, so important in Burgundy, you know, with the old building, you know, with the not ancestral but old method, you know, exactly the same than 100 years ago, working with the barrels, voilà, and at the same time, voilà, all these connection with the terroir, so rich in Burgundy, you know, ought to understand that if you have a vineyard here, you produce a wine that is not exactly the same than the vineyard that is just at few meters, few feet. So, that was something very attractive for me. And I had the opportunity, to work with different negotiations. And in 2011, I joined the Maison Louis Jadot in Beaune as assistant, position of assistant of the technical director. So my position was to be a little bit the cellar master of the cellar in Beaune. A little bit the same shape, but a little bit bigger, voilà, in Burgundy. But that was really for me what I was expected. So, year after year, I grew up with Jadot. I learned a lot with the Maison Louis Jadot. Louis Jadot, founded in 1859, with only Pinot Noir and Chardonnay, only in Burgundy. So great story, an history with the Maison Jadot. Mm-hmm. Et puis, today, Jadot able to sell the wine in the world, especially in the USA, partnership with Cobrand that is so strong, Cobrand. So this is an importer, historic importer of Jadot in the USA from 1945, and in the 80s, the family who owns Cobrand decided to purchase Jadot. And so that was, the connection with the USA for Jadot was something very, very important and still very important. So, really a great maison with a great philosophy. Because it's not just, of course, Jadot today is successful and this is the expression of Burgundy, of what is the terroir in Burgundy. But it's a good philosophy, the respect of the terroir, of the richness of the terroir in Burgundy, about 150 wines, different wines per vintage, from regional appellation to Grand Cru, with the same attention to the details. So this is not unique, but you need to be very precise with your work, to be able to make a big blend like Mâcon Village, Beaujolais Village or Pouilly-Fuissé, as well as you are able to produce one barrel of a Grand Cru. So that was for me a great, great experience. Mm. Et puis, in 2016, Pierre-Henri Gaget and Thibaut Gaget, his son, So Pierre-Henri Gaget, the CEO of Jadot, and his son Thibaut, who is the manager of Resonance and the future Mr. Jadot, they propose me to move with my family here in the Willamette Valley to follow up the project of Resonance, to be on site, to be, if you want, the local winemaker, to follow the construction, to follow the plantation, et voilà. And we moved in 2017, and now we are here, and I am working at Resonance, and I am very, very happy. So this is great. So Resonance, if you have some questions, don't hesitate to.
Just keep going.
Parce que you put the penny là, no? So I will not stop. So, Resonance. So it's very important because this is the first time that Jadot is making wine outside of Burgundy. The first time, as I told you, from 1859, the foundation of Jadot. And you know what is very interesting? The same year, it was the foundation of the state of Oregon. So if that was not a sign, so Jadot decided to develop a project outside of Burgundy. So we did that in 2013, but Pierre-Henri Gaget and Jacques Lardière. So Jacques Lardière was the head winemaker of Jadot from 1971. 42 vintages as winemaker at Jadot Jacques. So imagine the knowledge of Jacques about Pinot Noir and Chardonnay. Jacques started to work with Mr. André Gaget, the father of Pierre-Henri Gaget. Now he's working with Pierre-Henri and Thibault. So voilà, this is the link, the memory of Jadot, Jacques, really. And Jacques, was officially retired of his position of head winemaker at Jadot at the end of 2012. Mm-hmm. And for Jadot, that was the perfect opportunity to start the project. Because at this moment, we had the team, we had one guy available, bah, voilà, to start the adventure outside of Burgundy. So Jacques, available, more available than when he was a winemaker at Jadot, but moved, traveled, you know, of course, before he traveled to promote Jadot, and he had already some good ideas, like Pierre-Henri, like Thibault, where are the best region, you know, for Pinot Noir, of course. But Jacques had the opportunity in spring 2013, voilà, to travel and to spend time in the Willamette Valley. Et puis, ben, visiting the vineyard, Thibault Gaget joined him, and they had a visit at Resonance Vineyard. They met the owner, Kevin Chambers, at this time. Kevin was, he's still, but at Resonance Vineyard, he was a farmer, a grower. He was not a winemaker. So no facilities, no winery, just a beautiful vineyard, mm-hmm. 20 acres, about 20 acres on a property of 32 acres. 20 acres planted from 1981, only Pinot Noir, ungrafted, non-rooted Pinot Noir. So, good vineyard, you know, to start the project. And Jacques, visiting the vineyard with Thibault, had the feeling that there is something special at Resonance Vineyard, like an energy, you know, something that you can feel. That was the beginning of the project, finally. The roots of the project. Pierre-Henri came to visit, and they say, okay, let's do that. Let's try to make wine with the grapes of this beautiful vineyard that we did with the 2013 vintage. So, we signed the agreement a few weeks before the harvest, and voilà. And this is the very first page of the story of Resonance. So, but the experience of Jacques, and of course the team of Jadot, was really important to start this project, mm-hmm. because without that, bon ben voilà, this is not exactly the same timing, the same approach. With the idea here in the Willamette Valley to learn, not to come to say, okay, we will do exactly the same than in Burgundy, but no, to use the experience of the Maison Jadot about Pinot Noir, about Chardonnay, not to try to make a Burgundian wine, but to reveal and realize the complexity, the potential of the terroir, of the somewhereness here in the Willamette Valley, and especially here where we are in Carlton. In Yummy Carlton Navy. So, yep. Voilà.
That's a lot.
Ah ouais.
I'm going to back up for a second. I'm curious about your education. Tell me about learning wine formally, and what you when you got into actually doing wine for a living, what was different about it from your formal education? What did you still have to learn?
Oui, well, of course. So as I told you, my first approach about the wine was not especially to make wine, was not to test the wine. I have a great passion for the wine region, you know, all the grape varieties, the complexity of the wine, of course the beautiful wine. And I think I am curious. So, with the time, voilà, I discovered the wine region, I learned, I started to make a collection of bottles too, when I had the opportunity finally for me that was an opportunity to change my career, And with the years that I spent in the family vineyard, to learn more, that was for me the moment to learn more. How we can make wine, how we can reveal the complexity of one place, one location, mixing, the tradition, et puis at the same time, about all the knowledge that you can have to have the best expression of the grape. So really, the National Diploma of Enologist is a great, formation is a great training, a great diploma, because you learn about wine, but you learn about making wine and about all the complexity, of the wine, the chemical part of the wine. This is so important, the yeast, the bacteria, all the what is still a little bit magic for us, But voilà, you try to bring an explanation to that, about the reglementation to parce que you. Today you can't make wine like that, especially in Burgundy, the appellation is so important. So that was something complex. And of course, continue to test, all the complexity of the testing, it's not just some words. This is more the memory, something. Voilà. So that was really something great. Alors, about the knowledge, that was perfect, about the practice, about the experience, and I think it's a little bit the same in the USA, but when you leave the school, when you leave the university, you have to learn a little bit more. So this is really what I wanted to do, to work more, but to use my knowledge to make wine, because you don't make wine with a book, hein. It's not a recipe. So I worked in different cellars to forge my experience, to develop that, and especially at the Château de Vinzel in Mâconnais, that was a great experience. Et puis, and then the Maison Jadot, yeah, clearly. So every year, I am still learning. So this is very, very interesting, because the vintage is really the revelation of something. The vintage is the truth of the location, but this is true. Every vintage is different in Burgundy, but here this is exactly the same. So sometimes you think that you have something beautiful ready to pick, and hop, you have a big cloud, and during a few days you have rain, and puis you change your plan, because finally this is not exactly what you expected. This is what happened a little bit last year here, but this is like that, and this is what is interesting, because sometimes you have to take a decision, that can make a big difference, I like this part a little bit, this challenge, that every year you. It's a lot of stress. It's a lot of part of things that you can't control until the moment of the grapes are here at the winery. But this is exciting, finally. So, et puis, today, because I am here, I realize the idea to learn about the terroir, the somewhereness here in the Willamette Valley, different from Burgundy. So not so sure that we will do the same, than in Burgundy. Hein? Maybe after a few years, we say, "Tiens, finally, this is better to have this approach than what we are doing currently." Bon, even if we think that working with Pinot Noir or Chardonnay, we have a little bit some good ideas, some precise ideas of what we have to do. But this is interesting. This is very interesting. Yeah.
Voilà. Talked about your work in France. I'm curious, working in a French winery vineyard versus working in Oregon. What is similar, and what are the biggest differences working in Oregon?
In terms of the cellar, the winery itself, for me, yes, it's different because, where I work at Jadot, you know, that was really bigger. Mm-hmm. But by the size, but finally, the organization of the work, that was a little bit the same. Just the difference that we had more, the team was bigger, clearly, and we work with more appellation, but same grape varieties, you know, Pinot Noir and Chardonnay. So, it's a little bit not so different, finally. Mm-hmm. Here, what was interesting, c'est we started with nothing. As I told you, the winery was not here. So, in 2015, we had the opportunity to purchase a beautiful property near to Resonance Vineyard, you know, about 300 acres, without vineyard. So, a big, big potential to develop. So, that was really something that that was exciting, you know, to start with nothing, to plan and to build. Mm-hmm. So, we had to build this winery. And when you work as a winemaker, it's not so common, you know, to have to work your winery. So this is something that you prepare, that you have to think, and you change, you update your drawing, you know. Et puis, when it's done, you say, "Ah, mince, maybe we had to do that," or but it's okay. This is good. So here we decided to, because it's smaller, we decided to use a little bit the location, the profile of the location to be the winery. So thinking about gravity, mm-hmm. you know, that was something important that we do at Jadot too, between the tanks and the cellar. So voilà, same schema, same approach about the quality of the work, you know. Et puis, thinking about the future, because today, we have a certain production, but the project of Resonance, it's to grow up, not too quickly, but to grow up. And so, voilà, maybe to build something enough big for the next 5, 10, 15, 20 years. Of course, we don't know. We don't know what will be the... I hope the success of Resonance in the future, but that would be a good problem if one day we have to put the wall, but make sure we don't build something too small immediately. So that was interesting. That was really a great experience. And to choose your equipment, the same, you know, we know what is working very well at Jadot, so the idea to choose a little bit the same, the tanks, for example, that we have, the horizontal tanks, the same than we have at Jadot, the vertical with the pneumatic punch down, the press, and of course the barrel, so important for us. Alors the barrel, even if we have beautiful oak trees here in the Willamette Valley, unfortunately we can't use these species of oak because they are too
endangered?
The flavors are really too intense for the wine, for the delicateness of Pinot Noir, you know. So we work with French oak and we work with Cadus. Cadus is the cooperage that Jadot decided to create with a partnership, you know, with a partnership with a wood supplier, le Mérandier of Jadot. They started in 1996, the project of Cadus, without the idea to make a big business in the wood, in the barrel industry, but to have the opportunity to select, you know, the sourcing, the oak, the grain of the oak, mm-hmm. where the oak is coming from, and to produce one barrel, to try to bring a nice complexity to the aging of the wine of Jadot, and today of the wine of Resonance. So we use exactly the same barrel than at the Maison Louis Jadot, no difference. Same shape, same volume, same diversity of the wood. We work with different forests, and the age of the barrel that is important. Mm-hmm. Voilà.
So you were hired here when the vineyard was here and really nothing else yet at that point. So tell me about kind of figuring out the plan and kind of your role in figuring out the plan and coming up with these buildings and looking at the future for planting. What was your role and at what point did it kind of start coming into fruition?
Oui, bien. That was important for me, I think, to have the opportunity to arrive before the construction. And clearly, when I arrive, we had nothing, except the beautiful vineyard of Resonance Vineyard. But I remember that. So this is a true story. When we arrived, so in 17, you know, I took my my bike, and I went up, sorry, at the top of the hill of the tasting room. And we had a field of blackberries and thistle. And so I arrived with my bike, and I left the hill with my bike on the side because I had a lot of needles in the tires. But this is a good memory. And today, when we see the result, when we see the beautiful building of the tasting room, you know, wow, we say how much progress, you know, in just a few years. So that was very valuable for me to discover the Willamette Valley and especially the property before to start, before to build, before to produce. This is very, very interesting, you know, to plant. When you see the very small plant, the vine that you plant, and 3 years after, how big or vigorous is the plant? Wow, you say, it's a little bit a part of your work that help to do that. Mm-hmm. So this is very, very valuable. Et puis, for me, that was a big change. You can hear my English today. it's more French-ish than English, but when I arrive, you know, that was not so easy. You know, the first meeting that I had in the USA at Resonance, that was a construction meeting. Bon, alors imagine, that was the guy of the construction crew team with the big bird, and they were discussing together. And I say, whoops, if it's like that, I will not understand a lot of things because they had an accent, you know, and they speak together about technical terms. Et puis, no, I am so happy, voilà, I am able to understand, I am able to try to speak English. So, no, that was important for me, mm-hmm. because, of course, I needed time, you know, to make the transition between between French and English, between France and USA, or whether in addition to what we are seeing, but I think the Willamette Valley to have a transition between a French lifestyle, especially a Burgundian lifestyle, you know, where the quality of the life is so good, with the gastronomy, with the wine, I think the Willamette Valley is really a great place, a great location in the USA to live, and especially to move from France, from Burgundy. People are so welcoming, so friendly here, that helps really. That was. If I have something to keep from our moving, that was what? The help of the people when we arrive, you know, this generosity, this is very appreciated. This is something that, you know, that gives you the motivation to stay here. And of course, the food and the wine in the valley too. This is something, you know, for us that is important. So the first step of the transition of the new position work at Resonance, and of course the time to learn more about the terroir, the somewhereness, but that means the climate, the geology, the elevation, you know, the work, because we have, even if we try to use our experience of Burgundy, for example, for the cultivation, for the vineyard management, you can't do exactly the same than in Burgundy. So. That was very valuable for me, voilà, to spend time in the vineyard, mm-hmm. you know, to be with the worker in the vineyard, to understand that, to have a good feedback about that too, et puis to follow the construction, voilà, et puis now, but to be a little bit the link between Jadot, between the French team, et puis what we are doing at Resonance. So it's important for me to to speak French with the team of Resonance. voilà. So this is that.
You talked about getting to know the vineyard as being one of the most important things. Tell me about your initial impressions of the terroir here and how you've seen it expressed so far.
This is very interesting, yeah, because it's very different from the geology, for example, from the terroir we have in Burgundy. In Burgundy, if we think about the soil, if we think about the rock, we have a lot of limestone. Bon, different age, different color of the limestone due to the age, different mix with the clay too, depending where you are in the Côte de Beaune or Côte de Nuit, of course. So in Burgundy, clearly, we are not so close to the ocean. So here, the influence of the ocean is very important. Helpful sometimes maybe less, but this is a part of the terroir. Something that we don't know that in Burgundy, clearly we are far from the ocean. The climate is not the same due to the influence of the ocean. In Burgundy, you know, the winter are often cool, you know. We have some snow, not too much, but we have. But I think if you compare the average of the temperature, it's really lower in Burgundy during the winter and the summer. You know, different too. The continental climate that we have in Burgundy, here this is something we don't know. The result of that, unfortunately. Sometimes that means with the very warm day that we have in Burgundy during the summer and the cool air that are coming from the north during the summer evening, that can create some fight, you know, some storm. Sometimes with hail, we can think about the result of that when you see a vineyard after the hailstorm, you know, it's so sad and so dramatic, you know. But here, this is something that we don't see. I have to say, in general, it's a little bit sorry, more balanced here, more soft. And that means the winter are good if we think about the vegetation, maybe less about the human, but that means not too cold, but we have really the temperature that are helpful for the plant to have, we say, a step of dormance. That means for the soap to go down and really to have a break for the plant, for the vegetation. A lot of water, a lot of rain, so that give really the water that the soil need, you know, especially with the clay that we have here, that has the property to retain the water. This is very good. The spring, a little bit the same, you know, this is finally the transition, but a true season, you know, between the winter and the summer. Sometimes a little bit humid than other, et puis the summer, we can see currently, you know, very warm days, but And I think this is the key. The night are cooler, and often bring the freshness, you know, a good transition to the very warm days. So that give finally all what the plant needs to be strong and to be able to give the ripeness to the fruits, quoi. So this is very different. So that clearly, just that to explain, and of course I forget some element, but the elevation, of course, the orientation, it's more similar. But everything to say that finally, if you check all the detail of the terroir is different, except one important thing, the same grape variety. So finally, that gives the proof that even if the conditions are different, the expression of the Pinot is interesting because it's not so different. And what is interesting, you know, sometimes we have some similar expression between the Pinot Noir in Burgundy and the Pinot Noir in the Willamette Valley. Mm-hmm. I read a very interesting article recently that mentions the daylight you know, and it's very interesting, but we have the same between the city of Bonn and the city of McMinnville, you know. So this is what the grapes need, you know, what the plants, so we need, and of course the fruits, but to be ripe, mm-hmm. and this is very, very important, I think. So, alors, the work in the vineyard, of course, that was important for us to use the techniques of the Willamette Valley. That means not to say, okay, we want to do the same than in Burgundy. No, because it's different, you know, especially the density of plantation are not the same, so the equipment are not the same, the leaves area, mm-hmm. it's a little bit bigger here, but this is due to the density, a little bit the same, the time that you need to have the fruits ripe, between the moment of the bloom and the harvest, but this is not the same average, the same number of days than in Burgundy. Bon, voilà, so some vineyard workers have already a very good experience about the Willamette Valley. Mm-hmm. Especially for us, we decided to plant, so for the plantation that was important, to work with the local specialist, finally, to use the same density, the same organization of the vineyard. However, that was important to bring a part of our experience with the idea to mix, for example, the clone. Mm-hmm. Instead of speaking about one block with one clone, one selection, you know, coming from one plant at the beginning, mm-hmm. eh bien, we think more about massal selection, and we mix. So that means today, for example, if you look the hill of the tasting room, eh bien, this is a mix of Pommard, of Dijon, of Wedensville, of Coury, of different clonal selection of Pinot Noir. In fact, to think more about the location, about the hillside, about the place where we are, than about one clonal selection. Mm-hmm. So this is a little bit what we do often in Burgundy, especially at Jadeau, you know, the same, to think about the terroir. Mm-hmm. So voilà, so this is typically what we are doing at Resonance. So the Willamette Valley is so important for us, so we would like to reveal really this potential, this diversity, but using a part of the techniques of the experience of Burgundy. And for me, now after a few years, you know, here, it's still the beginning for me, but I think really when you see the geology, you have the feeling of a big, big potential. So mm-hmm. I show you, when we arrive at the winery, the profile mm-hmm. of the soil that we have. So here, I repeat, we are in Carlton, so on the western side of Carlton, you know, very close to the coast range. This is among the oldest marine sedimentary soil that we can see in the valley. Bon, it's difficult to speak about age, of course, but about 40 million years old. The development of that, so the rock and all the sediments at the top, mm-hmm. and depending where you are on the property, this is not exactly the same sediment. This is not exactly the same color. That means the expression of the minerality, because this is that what is important, will be not the same. When you see the roots going down and finally traveling in the past. With the geology, it's very interesting to see that the expression of that at Resonance Vineyard will be not the same than the hill that we have here on the back, and it's, half mile between the both of the hills. So this is interesting, and this is the sign of a good terroir. Mm-hmm. Alors, of course, you don't have a lot of options to reveal this terroir, but we have to plant. We have to produce, we have to make wine to see what will be a little bit the complexity, quoi. In Burgundy, you know the legend behind that, so of course it's not a new vineyard. Centuries after centuries, people work hard in the vineyard, and we say that's where we are, where we can see today some Grand Cru appellation via the monk, because they worked a lot in the vineyard, you know, to clean up the hill, to plant, and then to produce the wine. But we say that they tested the earth, you know, to with their experience, to have the feeling of a great location or not. So, maybe this is only a legend, but that explains that it's not magic. You can't just, okay, I will plant here and I will produce the best wine wherever you can be. But no, it's not so easy, you know. This is very important. Et puis, it's normal, you know. So this is really what we are doing. We plan to continue to learn about that and to have a better understanding about this geology, this complexity. We have the chance to own a small vineyard in Dundee Hills, Découverte Vineyard. Découverte means discovery, because for us that was a great revelation too. And the soil is totally different, so 10 miles from the winery, Découverte Vineyard. The Joey soil, the well-known Joey soil, so volcanic soil, younger, really younger than the marine sediments. Mm-hmm. Red color, you know, with the big boulders, you know, of basalt, so that give a very, very different expression of the Pinot Noir, even if we are so close. And this is only two vineyards. Alors, of course, some wineries have already planted a lot and have a better knowledge than us about that, about this complexity. But for us, it's interesting to do that too. Of course, we use the experience of the other winery here to continue to develop our project. But it's important for us to do that on the property, to try to plant and to see soon what will be the result, because this year, 2020, will be the first year of the production of the new plantation on the property. So very, very exciting vintage for us, even if this is maybe not the easiest year, you know, but voilà. So.
What have been your impressions so far of the wines you've made with the sites here? What have been your impressions of the expression, and what do you see happening to them in the future?
Alors, clearly I told you, and this is really not our goal, but it's difficult to make comparison, for example, with the Pinot Noir here and the Pinot Noir at Jadot. Both have great expression, but different. Mm-hmm. Here, often, we can have a very expressive wine from the beginning, you know, from the first month. It's already very, very open, very mm-hmm. expressive. I think this is due to the geology, you know, to the young soil, or young. when I compare with Burgundy, mm-hmm. The degradation of the rock, finally, Jacques will say the vibration of that, but yes, that give a certain energy. And I am always surprised, you know, when you smell the wine, when they are so young, you open a bottle after a few months of bottling. It's like you are smelling a fresh basket of fruits, quoi. And this is a little bit original. This is different, I think, from our Pinot of Burgundy, you know, of Côte de Beaune and Côte de Nuit, of Jadot. It's a little bit more. Less open, less so explosive, less expressive like that. Maybe more complex sometimes in Burgundy, but we need the time, you know, to revisit. It's like something that will arrive, you know, but mm-hmm. not ready. Very elegant, you know, very complex, but we need time. Here, this is very interesting because it's expressive, but you have the potential of aging. You can be patient, and that will reveal some nuance, some aromas that will arrive later. So this is maybe the main difference, knowing that we use the same method, you know, the same winemaking for the wine. So this is very interesting, you know, very, very interesting. Et puis, ben, in the future, I think in the future, what will happen in the Willamette Valley, ben, we will continue to reveal the expression of some special location, some unique location, some unique terroir, some awareness, as we want. And maybe, I am not sure, but I think, to continue to create some AVS. This is what we did in Burgundy. So in Burgundy, it's a little bit more an AVA because we speak about appellation. So we speak about a geographic location, but we speak about yield, we speak about condition of production. Voilà. Here, it's a geographic delimitation due to something unique. Mm-hmm. If we are in Yami Carlton, eh bien, we are not in Dundee Hills. Voilà. But that will continue. That will be more. If you look the map today, this map is very beautiful of the Willamette Valley. But I am sure we'll have more color, more classification in the future. Or maybe not a classification like in Burgundy. I don't think we need that. Maybe I don't know. But this is the reflection of the winemaking community. But maybe not the same model than in Burgundy with Premier Cru and Grand Cru, but sure, and this is, I think, the best way to follow, to think about, again, I repeat often the same word, but about the location, about the place where we have planted, because that makes sense. Quoi. So, voilà. So this is for me the future. After, we can see today a focus of the Willamette Valley on Pinot Noir, and Chardonnay more and more. That makes sense too. For me, when you see the minerality of the location, that will work very well for Chardonnay, maybe not everywhere, but most part of the location, if you select, that will work. Of course, but this is exactly the same in Burgundy, the influence of the weather. Mm-hmm. Bon, do we have to speak about global warming? I think something is changing, you know, but what will be the impact for the production, for the condition of production? So we don't know, you know. Maybe we'll have to make some change to adapt ourselves to that. But voilà, this is a part of the of the job. So we will follow that with attention, you know. Today, we are the 20th of August, August 20th, 2020. This is the first day of harvest in Burgundy at Jadot. I think we have to check in the past, you know, maybe in the 19th century or beginning of 20th century to see. But this is, if it's not the earliest, this is really one of the earliest. So. The weather, the influence of the weather, de toute façon, is important, ça, clearly. Yeah. Yes.
That's amazing. I'm curious, before you came to Oregon, sort of what your impressions were of Oregon's wine industry, and then kind of what your initial impressions were as you got here, as you started meeting other winemakers, other farmers around here.
Alors, that I will say, you will say he's crazy, but I didn't test a lot of wine of the Willamette Valley before. Mm-hmm. To be very transparent, honest with you, it's not so easy in France today to test wine of the Willamette Valley. Or it's a little bit easier now because some French wineries, you know, are producing here, of course, bon, Resonance, but the Maison Joseph Drouin that started in the 80s, you know. Now we have Jean-Nicolas Méo with Nicolas J, Louis-Michel Ligé-Belair with Chapter 24, of course Lingua Franca with the partnership between Larry Stone and Dominique Lafont. Bon, voilà, some winery, I hope I am not... forgetting some, but
it's most of them.
More and more and more. But so that give more visibility, I think, in France to the wine of the Willamette Valley. year after year, but the reputation of the quality of the Pinot Noir in the Willamette Valley is more important. But it's still not so easy to test wine. So I had the opportunity to test some wine with the Maison Louis Chadeau, but not a lot. And what I tasted, that was very interesting, you know. Again, different expression of the Pinot in Burgundy. Difficult to say better or not. Different, voilà. But very interesting. Interesting to discover that. To discover a little bit this region. I didn't know before. I have never visited the Willamette Valley before to move. Alors, this is between us, but we had the opportunity to come with my wife, because Pierre-Henri Gaget and Thibaut proposed me. He said, if you want to visit, voilà, you can spend 2 weeks, so why not? That can be important. That will be a big change for us. So, and we check, you know, on internet, you know, what is the Willamette Valley. Bon, we saw some beautiful photos, but some feedback of travelers too, of visitors. It's rainy. It's the Willamette Valley. So I told my wife, I said, what we will think about the Willamette Valley if we visit the Willamette Valley during 2 weeks and it's just rain. So finally, say, okay, that will be an adventure for us too. And we arrive in August 17. It was last weekend, more than 100 Fahrenheit. And we didn't see rain before, I think, November 2017. So this is just an anecdote, but very, very important for us, of course. What you say the future
impressions of Oregon wine as you've tasted it, as you've been here, oui, as you've tasted other people's wines.
That was for me very, very interesting, because in fact I realized that a lot of wineries, you know, are present in the Willamette Valley, with all of them, some bigger than others, some very small, but with this passion, you know, for the wine, for the production of the wine, and with very interesting expression of the Pinot Noir, especially. Alors, this is interesting because most part of the time the winery, you know, they are in one AVA. And so, if they work in Chalem Mountain, they produce grapes from Chalem Mountain. But now we start to see some extension of that, they produce other IVA, but we have some specialists of some location, terroir, you know, Chalem, Yola Amiti, Dundee, of course, and all this diversity of the Pinot Noir that aiguise mon appétit, that mean boost my curiosity, you know, about why so big diversity about Pinot Noir in just a very small region like that. If I think about the northern side of the Willamette Valley, you know, et puis when you visit, you can see the hillside, you can see the impact of the Van Duzer corridor, for example, of the geology, we spoke about that, of the temperature, the exposure, that explains that it's very complex. But what I will keep, you know, I will keep about my first, you know, arrival, my first tasting in the Willamette Valley, that was the curiosity of the winemaker, of the wine community, finally. All these, you know, these different experiences, these different origin, to produce today the same grape varieties here, I think this is a weakness, you know, because bah, voilà, step by step, you bring more experience. Bon, alors, me, I am bringing something from Burgundy. Maybe it's not. It's just a small stone, you know, on the pyramid. But I think this is the richness of the Willamette Valley. All these different, voilà, experience of winemaking, and you keep just the best part of these experiences to try to reveal. Again, the potential, the diversity of the Willamette Valley. So something that, for example, I appreciated a lot when I arrived. We have some events, some technical events between the winemakers. You know, you bring your bottle, your samples, up, and during one day, you share your experiences about one vintage with all the other winemakers, and most part of them are here. So this is something very unique. Not to try to say, he's better than him. Mm-hmm. No, this is not that. And this is just to say, voilà, this is what I did during this vintage because in this location I had this disease pressure. You know, I had this impact of the frost. I had this, and puis during the winemaking I did that. This is very valuable, you know, and without bad judgment, you know, again, this is just to go together on just one direction, the best direction, finally, the idea to try to produce a good wine. So that, for me, this is, yes, I say the richness, but the powerful spirit of the Willamette Valley today. So.
One thing you mentioned earlier that I found interesting, you talked about kind of the stress of the job, especially when it comes time to make decisions. One of the things we've heard a lot about the difference between making wine in France and making wine in Oregon is the amount of decisions you get to make. I'm curious about learning sort of to make wine without the restriction that there is in Burgundy, and what advantages and disadvantages that has for you as a winemaker.
This is interesting because sometimes, but when you have to follow too much rules, that give, and this is the idea of the appellation in Burgundy, this is, we say, un gage de qualité. That means you are sure that you will have a certain quality. Mm-hmm. But sometimes too much rules, we say, kill the rule. Especially with what is happening, you know, with some change about the weather, the season, the growing season. Bon, that can finally make sense, you know, to try some other option sometimes. Not to make a mistake, just to try, just to see what will be the result about that. So here, finally, what is the logic behind that? It's to try to produce the best wine, and finally to do that, to reach this goal, but to have not a lot of rules. This is finally the conception of two worlds, the USA and France today. But for a winemaker, this is very interesting to be able to try. Because when you try, you can have your own feedback. That means it's good or it's not good, or sometimes it's not too bad. Why not to try again next year and to see, you know? And puis after a few years, if you think that finally this is better to do that, why not to do? But I mean, in the future, maybe. Willamette Valley, and not only Willamette Valley, but that can be a little bit crazy to imagine that maybe we can impact, you know, some change in Burgundy. Mm-hmm. Why not? With some approach about Pinot Noir, some new techniques, some new, not winemaking, parce que it's not so big change, but voilà, some new approach. That can maybe be helpful for the future in other region, you know. So, no, I think this is interesting. Yeah. Mm-hmm. It's interesting. At the same time, voilà, as I told you, it's not magic. To make wine, you need the grapes. And so the key is really to have the best grapes possible. I say often, when I discuss with people or journalists, or is not very important, you can be the best winemaker in the world if you don't have beautiful grapes. Right, maybe you will do something not too bad, but you will not make a great wine. Mm-hmm. So really, this is the key to have the best grapes possible. Alors, to do that, here, for example, we are certified organic. You know, we not irrigate because for us we think that the idea to keep the main woods, to contrain these woods, to go down, to look for the minerality, the water, the past, finally, to travel in the past, in the geology, in the different geology levels. That makes a lot of sense. Mm-hmm. And it's really better than to see some roots at the surface where the soil is less complex. So, alors voilà, to do that, we till. This is a true job, quoi. This is not just, doing a few months. 8 months, we'll do the minimum, and then we will see. Then we'll do our best, using a lot of techniques, a lot of products, you know, to make wine. But no, finally, this is the opposite. During one season, from March, April to September, October, we need a lot of effort, a lot of work to produce a beautiful fruit, a beautiful grapes, and then at the winery, not to say we do nothing, of course, but it's really easier, you know, when you have a perfect fruit, it's easier and better to make wine with that. So, it's really easy for me to say that. Sometimes we try to do our best, and the result is not what we expect, because we work with Mother Nature, you know. But this is interesting aussi to do that, parce que we are very humble with that, and we learn again. Every vintage is different, so we learn every year. But voilà, this is a little bit my approach about that too. So,
You talked earlier about how this is Maison Jadot's first venture outside of Burgundy in 160 years. I'm curious if that adds any pressure to your job. Did you feel that you had extra pressure to make this thing succeed, internally or externally? And how has it manifested so far for you?
No, yes, of course. I'm aware that that this is a big project for the Maison Jadot, because behind Resonance, this is Maison Louis Jadot. But if I am here today, clearly, this is because the Maison Louis Jadot proposed me to come. And because Jadot is here to drive, to manage, to be a part of this project. Without Jadot, I will be in Burgundy. Clearly, that was not my goal to move and to come in the Willamette Valley. However, I'm very happy to be here because the Willamette Valley, as I told you, as I explained, this is something so beautiful and the quality of life that is so high, it's great, and the project, of course. But without Jadot, clearly Resonance will be not the same. So clearly I don't come every morning at the winery thinking, oof, I have to make the best wine, I have to of course I try to do my best, c'est vrai, but this is normal. Because this is the philosophy of Jadot. And the same, when you follow your philosophy, that means to spend more time in the vineyard, finally, to understand the season, you know, the the key of the vintage than to be in your office at the winery or in the cellar. Bon, but this is important. And finally, that helps you. Mm-hmm. When this is the moment of the harvest that you have to take the decision to cut, if you remember what happened during the season and you track a little bit the maturity of the wine with attention. Mm-hmm. But this is our job. We have some reference, you know, about the balance between the sugar and the acidity, you know, about the ripeness of the berries. Voilà. Et puis, and this is finally the most important. Well, I am just a member of the team of Resonance, you know. Of course, my job is important because the goal is to make the wine. But I have my assistant with me who is doing that. And we have the team at Resonance that help too. And of course, the team of Jadot. Mm-hmm. Parce que I was not the first, you know. Jacques Lardière was the first. And he's still with us. Hein? Jacques, today, is... it's difficult to give a title to Jacques, but he's a little bit our consultant winemaker, if you want. It was impossible for him to imagine to move with his family after all his effort, his life in Burgundy, but voilà, to move here. No, but he's with us when he's able to travel. Sorry. Of course, and Jacques for the techniques, but Thibaut, Gaget, Pierre-Henri, we test together often, you know, we exchange every week, if it's not more, about Resonance, about what we do, about the different projects that we have. Mm-hmm. This is important. Well, I spend time on the market too with Coburn, with our different distributors, but to do the same that we are doing, you know, maybe a little bit shorter, parce que, to speak about the project of Resonance, to explain why we are here today, finally, why we are making wine with Pinot Noir and Chardonnay in the Willamette Valley. So this is exciting, you know, this is very interesting.
What will determine if you're successful? What's the measure for success here?
To stay the same, you know, to continue to follow our philosophy at Jadot, to think about the terroir at first, to stay humble, to continue to learn about Pinot Noir and Chardonnay in the Valley, et puis that will work, you know. Voilà. Alors, I hope be able to produce very good wine with the new plantation. This is a very important step for us. Mm-hmm. To have the expression of new location, new hillside that we planted, new terroir, new somewhereness. Voilà, mm-hmm. This is really exciting for us to make the wine with this new from this new vineyard. Voilà, to continue to have the link with Jadot, et puis we'll see what I told you, what is important for us, and this is the same for all the team of Resonance. It's because we are aware that we are writing the first page of the story of Resonance, and for me, the feeling that the book would be big, you know. voilà, and ça c'est, this is a, voilà. Moi, I am very proud to be one of the guys who write this page. Voilà. So, but I repeat, Resonance, this is a team, and from the beginning it's like that. And I think if we are successful one day, that will be the result of the team, and not only of one people or only two people. Mm-hmm. Of course, we have some good people that help us, like Jacques, Pierre-Henri, Thibaut, some other people who help us, parce que they have a great experience, you know, and that help us, you know, when you have the feeling of Pierre-Henri about the business. Voilà, you understand that you know where you are going, you know. Mm-hmm. When you speak about wine with Jacques, ça va, you understand, you know that the experience of Jacques helps you. Bon, bah, this is very valuable, I think. But clearly, this is, voilà, the beginning. Mm-hmm. This is the roots of the project.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. You mentioned COVID and its effects, obviously, with your project just getting started. You mentioned off camera this was kind of the launch year for you. They kind of got interrupted. So tell us kind of about the impacts of COVID and the pandemic on your wine life and the project here and where you see what you see happening next as you come out of it.
Bon, but you know, finally, if we keep a positive thing in these crises, that we were all infected, we say confronté en français, we, all the countries had the same issue, you know, in France, in USA, bon, bah, we had to work with that. That was strange, you know, I remember in March, you know, when we had to take the decision to close the tasting room, it's not possible that we be just for a few days, allez, and then a few weeks, and then a few months, bon, bon, all weather. Voilà, this is a crisis, this is a sanitary crisis, like you can see a lot in the history of the humanity, you know, of the human people. So, we are enough smart and strong to continue, and I don't speak about reason, I speak about the world, but this is a, I hope we learn about that, will help us to be maybe more vigilant. Bon, clearly, when you think about the business, about economy, it's less pleasant. This is the bad part of the fact. Quoi. Of course, the people who were sick, it's too much. But the impact on the economy too, especially the restaurant, you know, the food and beverage industry. So we were directly impacted by that. By chance, in Oregon, the wine was recognized like essential work. So we were able to work at the winery. That was really one of our concerns, you know, what we will do if we have to close the winery and no more job, you know, we have to take care of our barrel. We had just to postpone a bottling operation of 1 month, so no impact on the wine, clearly. So that was okay. Now, we know that the pressure of this virus is still high, so clearly the harvest will be a little bit different this year. We'll wear our mask. We'll have some special protocol, you know. To try to be able to work safe, you know, in safe condition for workers, parce que this is important. Mm-hmm. Because this is important, so we. Sometimes I have a French word that arrives like that, but bon. the chance that we have here at Resonance, we are small. This is a small winery, so that will be easier for us to manage. But for a big winery, today, it's a challenge. Hein? So, bon, bah voilà, we will... I think, and I hope, next year that will be a bad memory. And in a few years, we say, you remember 2020, the bazaar of 2020. Just what we hope, c'est we will not need a second stay at home or shelter in place, you know, parce que for the business that will be not helpful. Of course, the same at the winery, the safety of our visitors and of course of our team is very important. But I think now, you know, we have some good reflex, like we wear the mask, you know, we try to keep some good distance. And we have to continue to work and to live like that. So clearly for the 2019 vintage, no, that will that will not impact the wine because we were able to rack when it was the moment to rack. It was okay. I hope we'll be able to bottle in good condition in 2021 because that will be that. For the harvest, we'll see. I touch wood. I hope everything will be okay. But as I told you, if we are vigilant, there is no reason that that will be a problem. In addition to the COVID, 2020 will be a year that we will remember for the season too, the growing season, because here in the Willamette Valley we had really a cool month of June that didn't help for the bloom, for the flowering step. We lost some fruits, clearly we had some coulure. This is that. This is not the first time, that happened. But in addition to the COVID, now we had the peak of heat. The weather that maybe will not help due to the evaporation, of the fruit. We start to see some fire around, Sam, I touch wood, I hope that will not impact too much the vintage. Mm-hmm. In Burgundy, one of the earliest vintage, we have never seen. So, early vintage normally is synonym of quality. I hope that will be that. Here, I don't want to speak too quickly, but all the light are greens to make a good vintage. So I think we'll keep that, better than all the difficulties that we had during this year. Voilà.
We can only hope.
Exactly.
So you mentioned this sort of being, like you say, that you're the author of the first page, one of the authors of the first page of the Resonance story. Tell me what you see as you look ahead for yourself and for the project here.
That means, sorry?
What do you see as you look ahead in the future for yourself and for the future of Resonance?
Clearly, c'est to continue to be the winemaker of Resonance. Maybe to have the opportunity to plant more vines, mm-hmm. To continue to try to produce Pinot Noir that express, a somewhereness. With more knowledge about that, maybe the idea inside our property to select the best block. We have already some idea with Resonance, but I'm sure that will be the same with the new plantation. To continue to dedicate the maximum of attention to the details to reveal the complexity of our terroir. Yes, this is a little bit that I expect in the next few years. Then, to be frank, I don't know. Maybe one day to have a great winery to be one of the good producers of Pinot Noir here in the Valley, to continue to work with Jadot. I hope Resonance will continue to have this strong link with the Maison Louis Jadot. We are French, I hope that will be not an issue for me, one day to have to change our plan because I am not a US citizen, but we have some techniques to be able to continue to work here. So this is a part of the project too. If I think about the future, one day maybe to have to increase the size of the winery, to increase the size of the tasting room, to have more wine, the portfolio of Resonance that can be a little bit bigger, range of wine, but keeping the priority, the focus on Pinot Noir and Chardonnay. Mm-hmm. So, for me, this is important. Mm-hmm. why not one day some Gamay? Why not? You know what is interesting when we arrive? So my wife grew up in Mâconnais, exactly like me. We came from the same region. And when we arrived, we saw the Coast Range. And we thought, both of us, we thought about the hillside of Mâconnais and Beaujolais, where we grew up. This is very similar. And finally, we are a little bit like at home. So this is great, you know. I have the chance to live on the property. So you saw a little bit that. You visit the property. So the beauty of the area with the Coast Range, hills, voilà, all these big oak trees. There is something special. So I hope that the Willamette Valley, you know, will stay like that. That will keep this soul, this quality about the environment, you know. Really, the expression of something still, we say, préservé, you know, not too developed, not too industrial a little bit, you know. So, bon, of course, I hope we'll see more vineyards, but planting vineyards with the respect of the environment, you know, of the valley, quoi. So that will be great. And the same, to continue to see some facilities like we can see in the valley, not too big, in connection with the spirit of the valley. That will make the difference for the Willamette Valley.
All the questions that I have for you. Is there anything I didn't ask that I should have? Anything we didn't cover here today that we should have covered?
Oh, I think we did a big tour of virtual tour of Voisin and Vire, because this is actuality. Now we have to do some virtual tour. So no. I think that was perfect. Thank you very much for all your questions. And Emily, no more.
Thank you so much. We appreciate your time and your stories and
your time.
Our time together.
Ouais, c'est vrai.
Thank you, and we're going to let you off the hook.